There we are. We're back on. Technical difficulties. How are we doing?
Good.
Yeah. Friday night. Did you guys watch the Republican debate last night? Anybody?
No.
No. Okay, well, I'm going to sum it up for you. Basically, Donald Trump didn't show up last night, and all the other candidates talked about him. Governor Chris Christie, anytime he was asked a question last night, he referred to his the "What Would Hillary Clinton Do" bracelet. It's like, Jesus, we don't need a man that's going to be going, oh, I've got to make a decision about the country. What would Hillary Clinton do? And every time they asked him about that, about his response involving Hillary, he would automatically say, you know, like, Hillary Clinton would be a nightmare as a president. You know who also saying that about him? The White House chef. Ooh, yeah, that guy had lap band surgery. You know that a couple years ago? And that is the only time I think I've ever seen lap band have the reverse effect on someone. I think his stomach ate his lap band. And of course we have Jeb Bush. Jeb, who had to reinvent his campaign several times along the way. His slogan was, Jeb can fix it. And now it's just Jeb with an exclamation point. Or as I like to say it or call it is, Jeb! It's Jeb! Jeb's ready for president! So that was the Republican debate. Not worth watching at all. I regret that. I think I was stoned. So there's a lot else going on in the news. What was it? The guitar player for Jefferson Starship. He passed away the other day. And we've lost a lot of music talent. Back in December, we lost Scott Weiland, David Bowie, we lost Lemmy from Motorhead. And, you know, Keith Richards is still alive. This fucker fell out of a palm tree 10 years ago. You know, he's like the poster child for why you should do drugs. So, we have any parents in the house tonight? Parents? All right, so that means the rest of you are non-parents, right? Give it up for yourselves, non-parents. Good decision, non-parents. See, I'm a mom, which means I haven't had a decent night's sleep in 12 years. And it all started when I brought her home from the hospital. Guess I should have left her there. My kid's cool, though. She plays hockey. It's really cool. What isn't cool are the team names she's been on over the years. 1 year she played for the Walleye. Like, that was a, let's go Walleye. I was hoping the coach's outfits were going to be the Gorton's Fishermen. I nicknamed them the Fish Sticks. I got all the kids yelling in the locker room before their games, let's go Fish Sticks, let's go Fish Sticks. Yeah, fan the kids. 1 year she played for the Cougars. That was weird, cheering, let's go Cougars! Felt like I was cheering on a bunch of 45-year-old women trying to pick up 18-year-old boys. Last year she played for the Predators. Yeah. You try to yell, let's go Predators! Sounded like I was cheering on a bunch of 45-year-old men trolling for 8-year-old boys. It's tough being a hockey parent. It really is. You have to put up with the other fucking hockey parents that are there. They're constantly yelling at their kids on the ice, skate harder, Jimmy, skate harder! Ice it, Timmy, ice it! Calm down, they can't hear you, you're not the coach. So one game I decided I was gonna try it out for myself, see what it felt like to be an obnoxious person. So I started yelling at my kids, skate harder, or skate harder! Mom's got 6 G's on the skin! They're looking at me like, what? Hey, I gotta pay for her college somehow. She's not gonna get an athletic scholarship with a play like that! Yes, so, I have a daughter. Ellen, you would like this. My daughter's middle name is Halen after Van Halen. Not Van Hagar. Being a mom, it's tough. I thought I was going to be really sad watching her grow up. She's like 12 now. And I really did. I thought I was going to be, oh, she's so little, she's getting older. No. I was happy. I've been happy the older she's gotten because that means the less kitty shit we have to do. I was glad we stopped having to go to birthday parties at Chuck E. Cheese. You ever been? Yeah, fuck that place. It's scary. You go in there, all these kids are all running around, all hopped up on pizza and sugar. It's enough to make me want to get my tubes tied. They need to offer speedball tickets for free abortions and vasectomies. They need to use that place as a scared straight situation for those teen girls that want to become moms. Instead of a bunch of inmates, they'll be faced with a bunch of snot-nosed kids and a giant rat. So my daughter really pissed me off last week. We were driving around, and she plays bass guitar, which is really cool, and was listening to the oldie station or classic rock, and that Phil Collins song, In the Air Tonight, came on, and I was like, oh, Aurora, listen to this song, it's really awesome. And it's got a great drum solo, you know, you're really into music and stuff and learning this, and she's listening to it, it's playing, and she's like, she looks at me and she's like, Mom, the song is boring, turn it off. I'm like, no, it's coming, the drum part's coming. And it comes and I'm over there air drumming in the car like an idiot. And she's looking at me and she goes, Mom, Nickelback has better drumming than this. For a brief, very slim moment in time, I wanted to drive my car off the road and hit a tree in hopes that it had the Takata shrapnel-filled airbags in it. I work in Southwest Detroit, Michigan Ave, Illinois area. It's the former red light district. I say former because the lights haven't been on in 6 years. My office is located next to an abandoned strip club. It used to be called Starvin' Marvin's, where all the dancers were either anorexic or from Ethiopia. Ham sandwich would get you a lap dance. Walking with an olive loaf, you were the big baller. Now, it was recently sold, the building next door, and the new owners are going to open it up as another gentleman's club, because what does Detroit need more of? And I thought it would be kind of neighborly of me to maybe, you know, suggest some new names. We don't need another Starvin' Marvin's. I was thinking maybe, I don't know, the cesspool? Maybe the twerking jerk. How about Daddy's Little Disappointment? And if you can't wait for that one to reopen sometime this spring, you can just go up a few blocks on Michigan Ave and you'll hit the Sting, which is also the name of the sensation you'll have after leaving. I got offered to buy drugs on the street outside my office one day last week. Yeah, you can applaud that. I had no idea what the fuck he was selling me. I'm like, he comes up to me, he's like, man, you want some candy canes? And Christmas is over with. It's like, no. You want some snowbirds? I don't care for Anne Murray. I was like, no, you want to go skiing. What the hell are you? I don't know you. Why don't I want to go skiing with you? He says, no, you want some blow. And I'm like, oh, blow, cocaine. No, I do not wish to purchase said cocaine. I mean, what about me? Says, yes, that's a cocaine user. I'm going to go ask her. Like, the worst thing I do is I drink boxed wine and smoke a little weed. Yeah, weed. That always gets a cheer. Weed. You want some right now? But, you know, sometimes in the area I work in, it can kind of feel a little exotic sometimes. And some people refer to the area as the ghetto. It's not. If you refer to that area as the ghetto, I will gladly present you with a bottle of Flint mineral water to drink. No, I don't call it the ghetto because sometimes it feels a little exotic. Sometimes, every once or twice a week, it feels like I'm in Spain running with the bulls. Okay, it's a pit bull and it's chasing me from my car door to the office door, but it's still the same thing, right? Everybody doing good still?
Yes.
All right. Come on, talk back to me. This is how it works. You know, if I ask a question, I expect a response.
Yes.
All right. I just forgot what I was going to say next. That's why I asked you a goddamn question. how did I know my husband was the one? He's sitting right there, by the way.
Get ready.
Renee.
How did you know he was the one? Well, simple. That one afternoon when that little plus sign showed up on the home record, you kind of figured we're in it for the long haul. So a lot of people don't know about me is, I say I'm an atheist. It's more like a agnostic, you know. I really just don't give a shit about religion. And having my in-laws, and I'm sorry to do this, babe, but I have to do this joke, but my in-laws make it really easy to think atheism is a really good choice. My mother-in-law claims that she's a prophet, talks to God one-on-one, has that direct red phone to God. No, you don't. It's like if an adult still believed in Santa Claus and was writing letters to Santa Claus. You wouldn't trust that person with your kid. You would call that person crazy, right? And then my father-in-law, he prays to God that he wins the lottery. Fine, but the thing is, you have to actually buy a lottery ticket. God's not going to send down the lottery angel and tuck a winning ticket underneath. He doesn't gamble. He doesn't gamble because that's considered a sin. So it's like, okay, yeah, atheism. Not so crazy after all. I have a question. If you were born on a commune and you were raised on a commune or spent any amount of time on a commune, does that make you a communist? I'm 33 years old, gonna be 34. My mom still gives me cash for presents. I shouldn't complain about it, but sometimes the amounts that she gives me are kinda odd. Like, but she'll give me $25 at Christmas time, like, all right, mom, I'm not hurting for money, thanks. One year she gave me $95 for my birthday. Like, why, this is an odd amount, $95. With a discussion with my dad, was, hey, Howard, what should we get Adrian for our birthday? How about $90? He's probably looking at her going, that's not enough, Beverly, we need to give her more money than that. Okay, $100? Where are we made of money, Bev? Well, I know the amount was $100 that she was gonna give me, and then on the way over to my house, she's like, what? We don't have anything to put the money in. Pull over. So, one last question, or a little, not really a question, a little thought I'm gonna put in your head. They say men smoke a lot of weed. They tend to have a low sperm count. Really? I don't think so. I think maybe they have a lot of sperm, but that sperm just has low motivation. All right, coming up to the stage next is, couldn't remember his name, so I wrote it on my hand. Don't judge. The most autistic man in show business, Andrew Ackner.